Today, I'm sitting here together with Professor Wolfgang Schön, who was invited to the European University Institute this week. Professor Schön is Managing Director of the Max Planck Institute of Tax Law and Public Finance, Honorary Professor at Ludwig Maximilian University in Munich, and Vice President of Deutsche Forschungsgemeinschaft. Later today, Professor Schön will deliver a lecture on taxation and democracy, to which we are already very much looking forward. Therefore, we will use this opportunity to discuss with Professor Schön two topics in taxation, one being tax and corporate governance, the other tax and democracy. But before we start off, I would like to ask you a few introductory questions on the organization and the activities and research project of your wonderful institute, which forms part of the well-known Max Planck Society. So, how is the Max Planck Institute for Tax Law and Public Finance organized, and what is your role as managing director of such an institute?
Well, the Max Planck Society is a hybrid construction. It's a private organization, it's a members club, so to say. Scientists are the members of that organization, but it's funded by public money. Half of that comes from the German Federation and half from the German lender. And the Max Planck Society is devoted to foundational research, not everyday research. So also in the law institutes, in institutes in economics, social sciences, and the humanities, we try to do things that are not done elsewhere, or not as easily elsewhere. So for our institute, this is in the first place an interdisciplinary institute. It's law, it's economics, it's tax law, it's public finance, but it also goes beyond that. We do private law and corporate law, and our economists also go into areas like political economy and public choice. Being a managing director at the institute does not mean that I only manage. Still, the directors of Max Planck Institutes are invited to and want to be researchers. So we are the principal researchers at our institutions. In my case, that would be research in tax law, but also corporate accounting and private law. The other colleague which I have is Kai Conrad. He's a leading public finance and political economy scholar. And each of us has one of the two departments of the institute. And besides us, there are top-class senior research fellows, postdoctoral fellows, a lot of doctoral students, and of course, very, very devoted supporting staff. All in all, I would say 50 people. And the topics we address, as I said, go beyond what's typically done at the university. So you will not find a research project in our place on the interpretation of some provision of German tax law. But there are different ways to go. We do interdisciplinary work between law and economics. We do international law, for example, on international tax coordination. We do European law, for example, the future of taxation in Europe. And we also try to do a lot of comparative stuff. So how a specific topic is dealt with in different countries. In so far, we try to supplement what's going on in universities rather than duplicate it.
Okay, perfect. I would now want to lead over to our first topic, that is tax and corporate governance. Tax plays an important role in every company, and it is well known that especially multinational companies heavily engage in tax planning with the purpose of reducing tax burden in order to maximize profits and thereby pleasing shareholders. In this context, I would first want to discuss a bit the company side. So, how are corporate capital market law and tax law interconnected, how they interplay with each other, and what is in particular the role of tax law in this framework?
Thank you. I think you can have a top-down approach as to that, and you can have a bottom-up approach. When you look top-down, you would look at the legal fields, and you would start out with company law, which addresses the principal agent conflict between shareholders and management, or between minority shareholders and majority shareholders, or the conflict between creditors and shareholders. That's basically what company law is about. And then you open the perspective and see the individual company being part of a capital market. Market for debt, market for equity, and how the company as such performs in that market. And that amends to a large extent what has been done by corporate law. And then you open the perspective even wider and you have the public domain, you have the public sector, you have the necessity to fund the public sector, but also the way government influences individual behavior. And the perspective we try to take at the Institute is to have an integrated view of all that. So that would be the top-down perspective. But you can also do it the other way. Look at the individual company, shareholders demand a profit, taxes are costs from the perspective of the management. So managers will start to think first, how do we make a profit? And second, how do we keep the tax burden as low as possible? And shareholders will agree with that. So also from the perspective of the individual business, it's necessary to have an integrated view of what corporate law requires and what tax law requires.
Thank you very much. So in June, the European Commission adopted an action plan for the efficient and fair and efficient corporate taxation in the European Union. The reason for this action was the perception that certain companies are artificially shifting profits to the lowest tax jurisdiction in order to minimize their overall tax contribution, resulting in the fact that certain profitable multinationals, such as Starbucks, appears to pay very little tax in relation to their income, while many citizens are heavily impacted by the fiscal adjustment efforts of their states. So this perceived lack of fairness indeed caused much public discontent all over Europe. So what are, in your view, the most important elements of the EU action plan on corporate taxation, and how do you evaluate this action in general?
Well, the new action plan, which has already led in recent months to a couple of directives and other decisions made by the European institutions, is indeed a shift of paradigm. When you look back over more than 50 years of European tax policy now, what you can see is that until a couple of years ago, European tax policy was largely about deregulation, opening markets, doing away with tax obstacles. So there were a lot of plans, and some of them have already been implemented, to liberate enterprises, to stretch across the boundaries of countries, and to organize what they do within Europe in the most efficient manner. And there have been a lot of directives. The fiscal interest of the nation states, that was, according to the old paradigm, something countries had to look after themselves. So there was not much work done by the Commission when they drafted directives to do something in favor of governments. Now that has changed dramatically. In the aftermath of the financial crisis and looking at the public debt situation in many countries, the Commission has turned around by 180%. And now they see it as their main task to support governments when it comes to the enforcement of taxes, when it comes to creating a level playing field for the tax inspectors, when it comes to increasing transparency by taxpayers, and the liberation of the market and the allocation of resources within the European Union is now on the back burner. It's still there, you will find it in that action plan as well, but it's clearly now of a secondary nature.
I have one related question on that topic. So it was in October 2015, only shortly after the action plan of the European Union was announced, that the OECD, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, with the support of the G20 countries, released its base erosion and profit shifting package known as BEPS. The OECD estimates that BEPS practices of multinational companies cost countries about $100 to $240 billion in lost tax revenues annually, which is the equivalent of 4 to 10% of the global tax income, global corporate tax income revenue. So against this background, over 60 countries working together in the OECD G20 BEPS project jointly delivered 15 actions to tackle tax avoidance, improve the coherence of the international tax rules, and ensure a more transparent tax environment. What are the most important elements of the BEPS actions of the OECD in your view, and what is your evaluation of these policy proposals?
Well, thank you. I think the first thing is that we have to take these numbers about tax avoidance and its effects on public revenue with a huge grain of salt. You mentioned those 15 action items. Now, there is one action item that is not very much looked at, and that's action item 11. That's finding out more about the true economic and revenue effects of tax avoidance, of base erosion and profit shifting. And the outcome in 2015 of that action item was, we do not know. There is still not enough hard, facts-based, empirical evidence on the sheer size of tax avoidance by multinationals. Everybody speaks of some huge and well-known cases, Amazon, Apple, Starbucks, you name it, but the true numbers are still unclear. But against that background, it's an enormous success by the OECD and the G20 and many, many other countries, which are now convened in what they call the inclusive framework, up to 100 countries, to have agreed on a certain set of rules, of provisions, including what they call minimum standards. Minimum standards being those which each and every country should apply and transform into its own policies. Now, the principles which they want to apply, they have come out quite clearly. Taxation shall be effected where real activity takes place, and all income should be taxed at least once in one place. Now, these principles have been agreed upon, but the big problem is nobody really knows where economic activity takes place, and nobody really knows where the tax should be levied. And what we see currently going on is another debate on that. Now, second point, the minimum standards they have agreed upon are not very impressive. So there shall be improved mutual negotiation procedures. There shall be some general provision against abusive behavior. There shall be country-by-country reporting by multinationals. Where do they make their profits? Where do they pay their tax? But a lot of substantive elements they didn't find consensus on, and these are all the recommendation, best practices, and time will tell whether countries really use those opportunities and accept those recommendations.
That was my impression as well regarding the minimum standards. So thank you very much. So let us now maybe switch to our second topic, that is tax and democracy, which is actually related to what we have discussed so far. In the lecture that you will deliver today, you will argue that both the theoretical and the theoretical model of congruence between voters, taxpayers, and beneficiaries, and the presentation of historical accounts show that democracy and taxation do not align as easily as the household rhyme no taxation without representation suggests. So, following the structure of your lecture, I would like to briefly discuss some aspects to the protection of the individual in tax, the international tax dimension of tax and citizenship, and the role of tax competition. So, conceptually speaking, how is the individual protected in tax? And might the protection of the individual taxpayer acquire additional constitutional constraints, in particular in minority-majority circumstances?
Well, the work which I'm going to present here today comes out of long and ongoing work in different fields of taxation. International taxation, where tax competition is regarded to be a danger to democratic decision making, but also the work which we find in Germany on the constitutional constraints of taxation, something we do not find in other countries, like the United Kingdom or the United States, where constitutional constraints are much lower. And we have an ongoing debate to what extent those constitutional constraints are meant to supersede democratic decision making. Isn't the community of voters, represented by the majority of voters, simply in charge of setting the public agenda, the size of the public sector, the size of distribution and redistribution? So that is something I want to start with. And the theory behind the lecture which I'm going to give today is that there are two completely different ways to protect taxpayers. One is to look for principles, guiding lights, constitutional constraints, like the principle of equality, like protection of property, like the ability to pay principle, which you find in constitutions around the world. And the other option would be simply to say, you have to agree. We look for consensus. And when you reflect on these at the same time, you will find out that you need them both. You need, on the one hand, consensus driven, which practically means majority vote driven tax policies, but you have to avoid, on the other hand, that either powerful minorities or the majority are able to exploit the system. And in so far, one also needs some constitutional constraints. And that has also been seen by US academics, both in economics and in law. Now, tax competition comes in here as well, because it's a third constraint. Those taxpayers who are internationally mobile, in particular those who don't even belong to the citizenry, foreigners, they can simply decide whether they want to leave or whether they want to come. And also that puts some pressure on the taxing state. So my assumption would be we need consent by the taxpayer, we need content, we need principles, but we also need a healthy, but not an unhealthy degree of tax competition.
I would like to pick one aspect of your lecture and particularly discuss more deeply. So in the abstract of your lecture, you mentioned that powerful political players, powerful private players, can encroach upon the democratic process. For example, when factor mobility and tax competition put pressure on the national state and its policy goals in the area of redistribution and the provision of public goods. So how would this process typically work? And what are the key challenges with regard to tax and citizenship in the international dimension?
So one of the basic findings of theory and empirical work in tax competition, and that's not done by lawyers, that's done by economists, but also by political scientists, is that tax competition depends on factor mobility. Those taxpayers who are mobile, for example, high net worth individuals, but also sportsmen and high level professionals, artists, they can put pressure upon people. Just to give you a very clear example, opera singers around the world don't like to pay tax. So wherever they go, they will only be prepared to sing when it is clear that their counterpart takes on board all the taxes that have to be paid. When Olympic Games are awarded, or the World Championship in football, FIFA and the Olympic Committee will not go anywhere where they have to pay taxes. These are situations where tax competition works very well for mobile factors. The immobile factors, and that's in particular the labor factor, the employees, they cannot move. So they are stuck to a certain extent. Either they agree with the benefits for the mobile factors, then they will have to pay higher taxes themselves, and redistribution will go down. Or they disagree, then the capital will flee and they might lose their jobs. So in the end, that's not a very pretty option they have here.
That is related to my next question. You point to the fact that we have to acknowledge that the relevant communities of voters, taxpayers, and beneficiaries do not remain stable over time. So, as taxpayers may leave the country and go to another jurisdiction, which results in shifting public revenues between these countries. So, my question is the following. How did tax competition evolve, and how does it put pressure on local policymakers? And in the end, is tax competition ultimately an obstacle to democracy?
Well, my thesis would be that tax competition has been around all the time. It has not been researched the way it has been researched over the last 20 or 30 years, but it has been there all the time. When I prepared for this guest lecture, I looked up the history of the first modern income tax act in Germany. That was the Prussian Income Tax Act of 1892. And when the draft for this legislation was prepared, the beautiful cities of the Rhineland in Germany wanted to have a clause in there that foreigners should not pay taxes, at least not to the extent the Germans would, because they wanted to attract foreigners to live in the beautiful Rhine Valley. But the central finance minister in Prussia, in Berlin, he was against it. So the legislation did not go that way. But tax competition pressure was there, and until this day we have rules like the ones people wanted to have in the Rhine Valley, in London, where you can live as a foreigner on a very low tax basis. So that has always been around. The impact on democracy is twofold. I see a beneficial and I see a problematic side. The beneficial side is that it also puts some pressure on the state. Insofar that those who are in the minority when it comes to voting have a second stick to apply. On the other hand, what we sometimes see, and we see it, for example, with regard to inheritance taxation in Germany, is that rich minorities buy themselves out. And we currently have a situation, inheritance tax is an example you can also see now with Trump's tax plan in the United States, but also in other countries, where only the middle people pay because the large majority is tax-free, the super rich are tax-free, and the people in the middle who cannot move but are not really poor, they pay basically the tax burden. So it's a mixed blessing, tax competition. I see a healthy side to it, but I also see that there might be some abuses.
Okay. So this brings us close to the end of our discussion. For the last few minutes, we could maybe try to integrate these two perspectives that we've discussed so far in the area of international tax competition. So what is in your view the most important task or the most important question that we should take on with regard to international tax competition that we have to solve now?
Well, first of all, it's interesting that the attitude towards tax competition has changed to a certain extent. When you look at OECD, they issued a foundational report in 1998 on harmful tax competition. And that report very much aimed at countries, jurisdictions dealing with ring-fenced benefits for international taxpayers, dealing with intransparency and all that. The current movement about BEPS is much more against companies and their behavior. But as every corporate lawyer knows, the aim of companies is to make a profit, and the shareholders want to have a big after-tax profit. So companies only react to what countries do. So the first thing is, what do we do with taxes, with the tax havens, what do we do with other tax jurisdictions? And in that respect, BEPS has already moved us a lot, because a lot of intransparent, artificial constructions will not be valid anymore in the future. But that brings us to a new reality of tax competition, which is, for countries, even far more dangerous than the one we have now. In the past, what companies did, they moved their book profits out. They moved intangibles out. But the work they did, the employment they generated, the production they had stayed in place in the industrialized countries. What we are going to see in the future is big industrialized countries competing against each other. The United Kingdom has announced that in a post-Brexit world, it might reduce its tax rate fundamentally. A couple of weeks ago, the US administration has announced a huge reduction in the corporate tax base, and to a certain extent also that's true for individual taxpayers. And that means that we might lose much more than a book profit and some tax revenue. We might lose the industries going elsewhere. And it is very clear that some countries in Europe, France and Germany did say that quite a lot, opted for some minimum tax burden in order to constrain tax competition, so have a minimum tax rate, etc. But even many countries within the EU will not agree, for example Ireland, where we have now 12.5%, and they might even go lower if others follow them. So the biggest challenge will be taking into account that the artificial constructions and aggressive structures will be done away with. The biggest challenge will be what to do about shifting of real activities, shifting of industries, shifting of establishments to other countries, and that is basically an open question.
I think that is a good point to finish our discussion. I thank you very much for your time and for sharing your perspectives on taxation with us, and we are all very much looking forward to your lecture today.
Thank you.
Thank you.